Welcome to the 9th lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. In the lecture today, we shall learn about the evolution of the Smith chart, how the Smith chart evolves from the simple relationship between the impedance and the reflection coefficient. Then we will go on to demonstrate how the Smith chart can be utilized for the impedance and the reflection coefficient calculations. And finally, we will see an actual Smith chart that one uses in practice. Considering the first part of today's lecture, we see how the Smith chart evolves. We have seen that there is a simple relationship that exists between the normalized input impedance and the reflection coefficient, that is Z is equal to 1 plus rho L upon 1 minus rho L, where the variable Z is equal to the normalized input impedance, normalized with respect to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, and the symbol rho L stands for the reflection coefficient with appropriate phase shift at different distances at a distance L from the load impedance. That is, it is rho times e to the power minus 2 j beta L, L being the distance from the load impedance. Both Z and rho L are complex quantities, and they can be written as Z equal to R plus j x and rho L equal to U plus j v. And we have seen in the last lecture that the points in the complex Z plane, particularly R greater than or equal to 0 points in the complex Z plane, map or transform onto points on the complex reflection coefficient plane within the unit circle. Okay, we've considered different possibilities for points on the complex impedance plane, normalized complex impedance plane, and we saw that all such points, as long as R is greater than or equal to 0, map or transform within or onto an area which is inscribed in a unity radius circle in the reflection coefficient plane. All right. We consider next how we may manipulate these relations for useful purposes. We write the relation as R plus j x equal to 1 plus u plus j v upon 1 minus u minus j v, and then we rationalize, so to say, the denominator by multiplying by 1 minus u plus j v and dividing also by the same quantity. This may be put in brackets, giving us the result 1 minus u whole squared plus v squared as far as the denominator is concerned, and in the numerator we get 1 minus u squared minus v squared plus 2 j v. All right. After this step, it is easier to separate out or compare the real and the imaginary parts on both sides of the equation. Thank you. That is right. Okay. And comparing the real and the imaginary parts, we get r equal to 1 minus u squared minus v squared upon 1 minus u whole squared plus v squared on one hand, and x equal to 2 v upon 1 minus u whole squared plus v squared on the other hand. All right. Next, we pose the question, what will be the locus of points in the complex reflection coefficient plane which have a constant value of the resistance? Or similarly, what will be the locus of points in the complex reflection coefficient plane which have a constant value of the reactance? Okay. Now, this can be seen rather easily by manipulating these mathematical expressions in a suitable manner. Okay. One can take the u and v terms on one side and try to put them in the form of perfect squares, and then it will be possible to see what is the locus of such points. Okay. So, quoting this result, skipping the manipulation, we see that we get u minus r upon r plus 1 whole squared plus v squared, which is equal to 1 upon r plus 1 whole squared on one hand, and similarly for the other equation, we get u minus 1 whole squared plus v minus 1 upon x whole squared equal to 1 upon x whole squared. Okay. It is fairly straightforward to come to these relations starting from these. And immediately one sees that, assuming that r is constant here, it will be a circle in the complex reflection coefficient plane with the center at r upon r plus 1 and 0 coordinate, and the radius as 1 upon r plus 1. Okay. And as we give or consider different values of r, we will obtain circles centered at different points and with different radii in general. Okay. So, constant resistance paths will be a family of circles. All right. What happens on the other side is also something similar. We will have a constant reactance paths, also a family of circles, with the centers at 1 and 1 by x, and the radius equal to 1 by x, taking care that we take the positive square root, so that the radius comes out to be of a positive value. All right. Now, one could consider different illustrative values of r and x and see what will be the corresponding centers and the radii. And as we shall see, that is the way the Smith chart evolves. So, let us consider different values of the resistance R and the reactance X, okay. And we put R here and X here. We start with R equal to 0. Okay, which will be a constant, which will be a circle with a center at 0, 0 and of radius 1, implying that if, for example, the load has 0 resistance, load is only reactive, the reflection coefficient magnitude will be 1. Okay. So, this kind of interpretations can always be offered. Similarly, for r equal to half, we have center at 1 by 3 and 0 and the radius equal to 2 by 3. For r equal to 1, the center is at half 0 with radius half. For r equal to 2, it is 2 by 3 0 and radius is 1 by 3, and if r becomes very large, say goes to infinity, then we have the center at 1 0 and the radius equal to 0. Okay, these are some typical values of the normalized resistance. Similarly, one can complete the other side for x values, taking on similar values. For x equal to 0, the center is at 1 infinity and the radius is also infinity. For x equal to half, the center is at 1, 2 and radius is 2. For x equal to 1, the center is at 1, 1 and the radius also is 1. For x equal to 2, it is 1, 1 half and half, and for x equal to infinity, it is 1, 0 with radius equal to 0. Okay. Now, these illustrative values of r and x are going to be enough for us to demonstrate what a Smith chart looks like. And actually, a Smith chart is nothing but families of constant resistance and constant reactance circuits. When these are plotted methodically, then we get Smith chart. A Smith chart is a plot of constant resistance and reactance circles in the reflection coefficient plane. That is what a Smith chart is. Now, before we show this family of circles, we see a very simple relationship between impedance Smith chart and the admittance Smith chart. So far, the way we have described it, it might appear that the Smith chart is an impedance chart. We are talking about the resistance and reactance. However, we have the relation for impedance as z equal to 1 plus rho l upon 1 minus rho l, and if we consider the corresponding admittances, and realize that the normalized admittance is equal to the reciprocal of the normalized impedance. Then we see that why the normalized admittance is equal to 1 minus rho L upon 1 plus rho L. Okay. And if we substitute for minus rho L a new quantity, say rho L prime equal to minus rho L, then y is simply 1 plus rho L prime upon 1 minus rho L prime, which is an expression which has an identical form to the expression for the normalized impedance, and therefore is going to have similar behavior. That is, if one plotted the constant conductance paths, they will come out a family of circles, and similarly if one plotted the constant susceptance paths, they will come out a family of circles with identical paths for identical numerical values, right. And therefore, the same Smith chart serves as an impedance chart, usually normalized impedance chart, and a normalized admittance chart. All that one needs to do is to transform the reflection coefficient by this amount, that is by 180 degrees. Okay, in the complex reflection coefficient plane, minus 1 is equivalent to a rotation by 180 degrees. Okay. So, if one has considered some impedance point in the on the Smith chart, to obtain the corresponding admittance, all that one needs to do is to consider the diametrically opposite point with the same value of the magnitude of the reflection coefficient. Okay. So, that aspect is extremely simple on the Smith chart, and therefore, the same chart serves as an impedance chart or as an admittance chart. Now, let us show you on the OHP a plot of these illustrative values. We first consider the r equal to 0 circle, and you see that that has a center at 0 0. This is the complex UV plane. So, center at 0 0 and radius is 1. So, with some scale you draw a circle with radius 1, and all points on the circle will represent r equal to 0. What will be different at different points on this circle? The difference will be in the reactance values. Similarly, one can see that r equal to half circle is this. It is obtained by considering the center at 1 by 3 0 somewhere here, and the radius equal to 2 by 3. So, this way you get the r equal to half circle, and so on, r equal to 1, r equal to 2. And r equal to infinity is just a point here with radius equal to 0, essentially the open circuit point. All right. Similarly, the x equal to 0 point is obtained or path is obtained by considering a center at 1 infinity. So, that is beyond this slide, and the radius also is infinity, and therefore, this is the this straight line u axis is the x equal to 0 part of the constant x equal to 0 circle. All right. Next, one can consider the x equal to half value, and that has a center at 1, 2 with radius equal to 2, and therefore, x equal to half plots like this. One can easily see mathematically that if one considered x equal to minus half, that will have a center at 1 minus 2 with radius equal to 2, and therefore, it will have a corresponding symmetric arc of the circle representing x equal to minus half. And similarly, one goes on to x equal to 1, x equal to 2, and symmetrically x equal to minus 1 and x equal to minus 2. And this is this can be considered to be the skeleton of the actual Smith chart. We will see the actual Smith chart a little later, but this will be somewhat more convenient for us to consider the various applications to which the Smith chart can be put. There are a few other things that are noted down on this. As we proceed, we will try to explain their meaning. The first application that we consider is that we are given the impedance. Given Z. Okay. And the question that is posed to us is find the reflection coefficient, or more specifically find rho n. That is the perhaps the simplest application for a Smith chart. Given the impedance or the normalized impedance, find the reflection coefficient. We know how it can be done using the formula, but how it can be done on the Smith chart, that is the question. So, we consider the example, let Z be equal to 1 plus j, and please bear in mind these are normalized values. Usually the Smith chart that is available in practice is also a normalized Smith chart. Now, how would one locate this impedance point on the Smith chart? Not difficult. The real part is 1. So, r is equal to 1. So, it should be some point on the r equal to 1 circle. All right. And what is the reactance part? X is also equal to 1, and therefore, it is the intersection of the r equal to 1 and the x equal to 1 path. We can mark it here. Okay, relatively thick, and call this point A. This is how one would mark various impedances on the Smith chart. All right. Now, what is the reflection coefficient? The Smith chart is already a plot of the constant r, constant x circles in the reflection coefficient plane. The distance from the center will be the magnitude of the reflection coefficient, and therefore, we say that the reflection coefficient magnitude for this example, this is rho or rho l. We have seen that the difference between rho l and rho is simply that of phase. Therefore, this is the magnitude of reflection coefficient, the distance of point A from the center. Taking the scale into account, the scale is that this distance is equal to 1. So, once that scale is known, it is obviously available on any Smith chart, this distance can be measured and it will be some quantity less than 1. For this example, this quantity is 0.45. All right. The phase can be read by considering this angle with respect to the positive u axis. Okay. This is the angle rho, or angle rho l to be more specific. Okay. The angle measured in the counterclockwise direction with respect to the positive u axis. That is how angles are measured in the complex plane. All right. Now, in this example, this angle comes out to be 1.11 radians, or the equivalent value in degrees, and most Smith charts are graduated on their periphery in terms of degrees and wavelengths. And therefore, actual measurements are not required, one just reads the values of the Smith chart. Okay. The corresponding value in degrees will be roughly 63-64 degrees. All right. So, this is one straightforward application of the Smith chart, that is, we are given the impedance value, we can convert it into the normalized value if necessary, and then read the magnitude of the reflection coefficient and the phase of the reflection coefficient. All right. We take up the next application of the Smith chart. And that is given, let us say, the load impedance. All right. And we are required to find say Z at different distances from the load impedance, or in other words, how the impedance or the load impedance transfers along the transmission line at different distances from the load impedance, what will be the impedance value. That is a typical problem that one encounters in transmission lines, how the Smith chart may be utilized for this purpose. Now, once again we consider some typical value, say ZL is equal to 1 plus J, considering the same example, seeing how convenient it is. So, this is the load point, say represented once again by point A. Now, comes a very important question. Depending on the question posed, that is, find the input impedance at such and such distance from the load impedance, we have to move from the load point. A is the load point representing the load impedance. Now, we have to move on the transmission line away from the load point. How this movement is to be accomplished? Okay, that is the natural question. Now, we realize that rho L, which is V naught minus e to the power minus j beta L upon V naught plus e to the power j beta L, as we move away from the load, it is L that is increasing. And that only affects the phase of the reflection coefficient rho L, it does not affect the magnitude of the reflection coefficient. And therefore, unless one encounters some discontinuity or some other change, as we move on a transmission line say away from a load point or some particular discontinuity, we will move on a constant magnitude of reflection coefficient circle. That is, the center will be this, okay, and this becomes the radius, and we will move on a constant magnitude of reflection coefficient circle. Okay. That answers one question about how we are going to move or what kind of movement is going to take place. Since the magnitude is not affected as we move away from a load impedance, the movement will be on a constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle. Right, that tells us the path.
So, when A be one of the point of that circle.
Now, if it is the load impedance that is given to you, depending on different problems, you will consider different load impedance values. So, they will plot appropriately at different points on the Smith chart, that is quite fine. But how are you going to move? The movement is going to be on a constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle. All right. This is point number 1. The second point obviously will be how much do we move. Now, how much is answered here itself? The angle is twice beta L. Normally, L will be specified in wavelengths, okay, and therefore, beta L will be easily calculated, and depending on this value, you move by that much amount on the Smith chart on the constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle. So, the amount is clear. Then comes the direction. One could move clockwise or counterclockwise. In which direction would one move? Okay. Then realizing that rho L is equal to rho e to the power minus 2 j beta L, as L decreases, the angle becomes less negative, or in other words, the angle becomes more positive, all right, and decreasing L takes you towards the load, and therefore, the increasing values of the angle will take us towards the load, and this is clearly marked on the Smith chart. The direction in which one has to move on the path earlier identified and the amount earlier identified, the direction is this. This movement takes you towards the load, this movement, therefore, by the same argument, the opposite movement takes you towards the generator. And these two directions are clearly marked. From a particular point, if one wants to move towards the generator, one will move on in a clockwise direction. If one wants to move towards a load, supposing it is not a load point, it is some other point, then one will move in the counterclockwise direction, all right. So, it is already shown here, the clockwise movement is towards the generator. Now, we know how to move, how much to move, and in which direction to move. All right. Coming back to our example, that it is the load impedance which is given to you, given to us, 1 plus j, and we require to find out z at a distance L equal to lambda by 4. Let us say. So, what is the input impedance seen for such a load at such a distance? Let us say that is the question posed to us. Then we mark point A, locate the load impedance, move with this as the center and this as the radius on a constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle, move by how much amount? 2 beta L. For this particular example, it will go to L is lambda by 4, beta is 2 pi by lambda. So, this will go to pi radians or 180 degrees. So, once again a setup problem for the sake of simplicity, and one will move in this circular fashion and reach a point like this, okay, on a constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle by 180 degrees. In which direction? Towards the generator. This was given to be the load impedance. So, we have to move away from the load towards the generator, and therefore, it is a clockwise movement as identified earlier. What is this value that we get? One can read it here. For this simple example, it is on r equal to half and x equal to minus half, and therefore, the input impedance in this case comes out to be z I is 0.5 minus j 0.5. Once the application is understood, this is a very fast process as compared to the complex calculations on the calculator. Now, the converse is also equally feasible, that is, given the input impedance at a certain distance from the load, determine the load. Okay. By similar arguments, one will start at this point and then retrace this path and reach this point. Okay. And therefore, transformation of impedance is possible in a fairly straightforward manner on the Smith chart. Let us take the third application of the Smith chart. And also, you would have noticed that the periphery is marked in terms of wavelengths, so that different distances in terms of wavelengths can be easily marked, can be different amounts of movements can be easily carried out. The third application we say is that we are given the load impedance. Okay, and the way we have written it, it should be clear that it is the normalized load impedance, obtaining which is no problem at all. We need to find out, let us say, the standing wave ratio and the locations of V max and V min. Those of you who have attempted these calculations would recall that these are not so easy, they take some effort. But on the Smith chart, these can be handled very easily, and one actually gets a feel of what is happening on the transmission line. This was one of the advantages that we quoted for these graphical aids, Smith chart, etcetera. The standard example we have been taking is that let ZL be 1 plus J, okay, which certainly is only for illustration. One can use this Smith chart for all other values also. All right. Now, how do we find the standing wave ratio? No, that is all right. Given ZL, you can calculate the reflection coefficient and calculate the standing wave ratio. Those mathematical formulae are there, they have their own value. Using this Smith chart, how does one do it? We use the simple fact that at V max, the input impedance is completely resistive and is equal to S times Z naught, where S is the standing wave ratio. Therefore, the normalized Z or Zn at all locations of Vmax is going to be equal to the standing wave ratio S. So, the simple procedure will be to move from the given load point on the transmission line. We have already seen what this movement should be like. It should be on a constant reflection coefficient magnitude circle. The direction also we have made out, to whether it is towards the generator or towards the load. All right. So, this is the load point, we start moving towards the generator. So, in the clockwise direction, and let us say this is the movement that takes place, something like this, and we stop at a point where the impedance is completely real, that is wherever we intersect the U axis. Okay. In this case, we stop here, where the reading here is, if you look at a detailed Smith chart, 2.6 So, for this problem, we see that S is equal to 2.6. And this Smith chart very clearly brings out the fact that this is going to be a periodic phenomenon. Okay. If we continue to rotate by another 360 degrees, which amounts to a movement in terms of wavelength by half a wavelength, once again we will come to a voltage maximum. Therefore, unless something else changes on the transmission line, there will be these periodic maxima, voltage maxima formed on the transmission line. Everywhere the input impedance seen at these locations will be S times Z naught. Now, you could come up with the argument that for this purpose we could have used the voltage minimum locations and the information that at V min the input impedance is equal to 1 by S, which is perfectly valid, equally valid. And for that, what one would do is one would continue movement towards the generator from the load point and not stop here, because this corresponds to the location of a voltage maximum, and continue on the same path and come somewhere here on the negative U axis, where the values are less than 1, and therefore, the reciprocal of that will once again give us an identical value for the standing wave ratio.
So, less than 1, then less than, I think that itself should bring the value of
no
2.6.
So, see, when the value itself was the standing wave ratio, and that corresponded to the voltage maximum location. For the voltage minimum, it has to be the reciprocal. All right. So, the standing wave ratio can be read, more or less read, on the Smith chart.
So, how do we get 2.6? So, it should be less than 1.
S is never less than 1.
So, but,
that
one,
is one thing.
That is one
see,
zero.
Now let us read the markings on the U axis. 0, R equal to 0, R equal to half, 0.5, R equal to 1, 2, and so on, it will go on to infinity. So, from 0 to the right of this 0 point, the center of the complex reflection coefficient plane, the values of R, normalized values of R, are greater than 1, and to the left they are less than 1, and perhaps the reason is there before us. Now, this information should actually be enough to make out the locations of voltage maxima as well. The distance that has been moved from the load impedance up to this location of the voltage maximum will give us the location of the voltage maximum. Okay? As I mentioned, the periphery is graduated in terms of wavelengths. So, this movement that we made in coming from the load impedance to the location of the first voltage maximum will tell us the location of the voltage maximum, and in this case V max is located at a distance which is 0.088 lambda from the load. And obviously, if one adds another lambda by 4, one will get the first voltage minimum from the load, and then you keep on adding lambda by 2 distances, and you will keep on getting more maxima and minimum. All right. So, these are the 3 representative very simple applications of the Smith chart, and we restricted ourselves to this limited form of Smith chart for the sake of convenience. Actually, what one gets to use is the following. And we will try to look at various features of this chart one by one. And I suggest that you look at a copy of the Smith chart and look at various regions as we go along. First of all, you see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 circles on the outermost periphery. Okay? And these are marked as movement towards the generator clockwise, and similarly movement towards the load. Okay? The requirement for this we have just seen. These outermost two circles are marked in terms of wavelength, so that the movements can be easily read in terms of wavelengths. So, we start at 0, go to a quarter wavelength here on the other side, and complete the circle by coming back to this point, that is half a wavelength. Since the angles are 2 beta L, half a wavelength completes 360 degrees. So, there are two circles, since there can be a clockwise movement or a counterclockwise movement depending on the requirement. In addition, the circle inner to these two is marked in terms of degrees. Okay? So, there are graduations of 10 degrees each, 150, 140, 130, 120, etcetera, starting from 0. Okay? 0 to plus 180 degrees on this side, and 0 to minus 180 degrees on this side. So, plus pi to minus pi radians. Then of course, we can consider the family of constant resistance circles. As you would recall, this, the innermost circle here, okay, this represents the R equal to 0 constant resistance circle, and its intersection on this real U axis is at 0. All right. Similarly, one goes on in the on the right hand side on this axis. So, 0, 0.1, 0.2, and so on up to 1, which is the center of the reflection coefficient plane. And then 1.2, 1.4, 1.6, 2, and then 3, 4, and this way going on to infinity. And there are all these circles, complete circles, representing the constant resistance family of circles. All right. Similarly, these arcs of circles on this side or on the other side, they represent the parts of constant reactance circles. So, starting from 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, you go up to 1, and then values greater than 1 going up to infinity here, and similarly negative values on the other side. And of course, there are a large number of curves, some full circles, some arcs, so that one can make finer readings on the Smith chart. Okay. This is where we stop this lecture. In this lecture, we have seen how the Smith chart evolves, what are the various simple applications of the Smith chart, and what a practical Smith chart looks like. Thank you.